All right, we're back in the war card game, and now we're going to add functionality to the deal button so that the user can tap on it. Now, if you're brand new to this series, click over here to start from lesson one. All right, let's dive in. All right, so here we are in Xcode looking at our war card game. Just to give you a reminder, let's just run it quickly and see what we can do with it. All right, so here it is. It launches in the simulator. We can see the cards. This button is not interactive because it is actually just an image right now. And these are the score labels. So going into the code that represents that user interface, if we scroll down, we're going to see our image element that represents that button right there. What we want to do is change that into an actual button, not just an image, right? So what I'm going to do is create some space here so we can work and you can clearly see what we're doing. I'm going to get rid of that image element, and that's going to disappear as soon as we make this preview live. There we go. What we're going to do is first add a button from the library. So if you remember, that is this plus icon up here. If you click that and you go under this first tab, which is a library of all the views, and button should be at the top. If it's not, you can always type in button. So we're going to drag and drop that right there. Now, this is a basic text button, and I know it's a little bit hard to see there in the UI, but we're going to start with just a simple text button to demonstrate how it works, and then we are going to customize that with the image, the deal image. Let's change this string. Remember, it's a string data type, it's a piece of text. We are going to customize that into deal. And now notice that there are a pair of curly brackets here. And in between those brackets, you put the code that you want to be executed when the user taps on that button. So why don't we go ahead and just put a simple print statement, and we are going to just print out deal cards. Now, when we tap on the button, when it prints this out, it will print it out into the console area. That is down here in Xcode. So let me just drag this window up here. It's got all sorts of information. Now, if you don't see this part right here, here's the button that you would click on. In the lower right-hand corner, you would see this little button here. You click it to bring up this debug area. And if you don't see two different sides to it, there are two buttons again in the lower right that you can turn on and off. So make sure that this side with all the text, that's the right hand side, that is toggled on, because that's where this is going to print out to. So why don't we again run this in the simulator? Actually, before we do that, let me just add a simple modifier so that this text button is more visible, because right now this blue text is really hard to see against the green background. Now, do you remember how to add a modifier? So you could very simply hit dot and then foreground color, and you can type in dot white to change that to white. Or if you didn't want to do that, you could always go through the library by hitting this plus icon, choosing the modifiers, and selecting foreground color, clicking and dragging right there, changing that default blue text to white. All right, let's go ahead and rerun this in the simulator. All right, so here's the simulator. I'm gonna tap on this button and it's going to run this code right here, print deal cards. As you can see, it is starting, each time I press it, it executes the code within those curly brackets. So great. Our button works. Now, the next thing I want to do is to incorporate what you learned about functions. So instead of simply writing the code here inside of these two curly brackets, why don't we call a function from here? So this function is going to perform the all the code related to dealing cards. So why don't we find a space to put this function? So this part, you have to be kind of careful about where to put this function, because I haven't really explained yet what these structs are and, you know, where you would put your functions. So I'm going to tell you where to do that now, but it's very easy to make a mistake. So here's what I want you to do. So put your cursor, let's say right under body right there, and you're going to go to editor, and you're going to go to code folding, and you're going to hit fold. You can also take note of these shortcut keys if you'd like. So we're just going to choose fold, and that's going to fold it all up neatly. If you want to unfold it, again, you just go to, you can either double click this actually. You could double click that to open up. That's probably the easiest way. So again, put your cursor under body. If you don't have a blank space here, and you know, you could do it there. All you need to do is actually make sure that your cursor is after that opening curly bracket of the body. And we're going to go to editor. We're going to go to code folding and hit fold. And the reason I want you to do that is because we are going to create a new line right before this closing bracket, but after the closing bracket of the body right there. And we are going to declare a new function. Now, I'm going to explain to you in future lessons why we are putting this where it is, and you know, what is a struct, how do you know where to put your functions and things like that. But for now, I just want you to follow what I'm doing. So type in func to declare a new function. We're going to call this function deal. And if you remember the syntax for it, pair of parentheses, which in between there you would put in any input parameters, right, that this function expects. For the purpose of this code, we don't need any input parameters, so it's just going to be an empty pair of parentheses like that. Now let's open up a pair of curly brackets like that so that we can actually put the code in there. Now in here, I'm going to put print deal up to declare a string. We got to use the quotation marks, right? Okay, so this function, all it does is print deal cards, just like what the button did before. And it'll execute this anytime you call deal. So now let's open up the body again, scroll down to our button, and instead of calling print right here, we are going to call our new function. And look at that, autocomplete recognizes it. And all we need to do is that. Now let's run it in the simulator and just test that it still works, because we don't want to make a mistake at this point. So tap on that button. As you can see, it still works, right? What's happening is that when you're tapping on the button, it's executing this function. If you scroll a little lower, this is what that function does, right? So now in the future, when we want to add functionality to the button right here, all we need to do is add the code in here.
So that's a basic text button, but what if we wanted to use an image for the button instead? Let's take a look at how we do that.
Let's scroll back up to our button element. As you can see here, the button that you add through the library in this way, it only allows you to specify a piece of text. So this is a text button. If you want to create a button which can be visually represented by anything you'd like, what you would have to do is type out button, type out the first opening parentheses, and you can see a couple of different options for buttons that you can create. And what we are looking for is this one right here, action and label. So action is what happens when you tap on it, and label allows you to put any sort of UI code in there, any sort of UI visual elements. So let's go ahead and double click this, and you're going to see this. These input parameters look a little bit different from this one, right? This one only had the one text parameter that you had to supply, and that was for the text for the button. This one has two different ones. It has action and it has label. So you can double click on any of these. So go ahead, double click on action, this part right here. And what's going to happen is it's going to change in this sort of format right here. This first set of opening bracket, this is the action for your button. So let's stay organized here. So I'm going to actually get rid of this text button first. Okay. And in here, under label, this is actually where we're going to put the visual representation, right? Label this set of curly brackets. Let's put in an image element. And our image name was button, right? If we go back to assets, that's what this is right here. Let's go back to content view and let's refresh this preview right here. Oh, okay. So we can't yet view the preview because we haven't filled in the code part yet. So you can actually just delete that code part and that will be valid. Okay. So as you can see here, we've got now a visual image of our button. And you see, this is the visual representation of the button. Now in here, this is supposed to be the action. Good thing that we created a function, right? We can simply call that deal function like that. Let's now run the app in the simulator again and take a look at what happens when we tap on our new button. So you can see it is an image element, but it is actually a button. And when we tap on it, it runs the deal function, which prints out this statement in the console area.
All right, now that we have the button looking the way we want, let's add some more functionality to it.
So we want our deal button to do more than just print out deal cards. We want it to actually deal cards, right? So how is tapping on this deal button and running this deal function, right? What sort of code can we put in here to actually change the images for this image element and this image element, right? And then how are we going to update the score labels here as well? Well, let's first take a look at what represents these things and see what we can work with. We scroll up. We can see that we have an image element that represents card 2. And this is referencing the image asset in our asset library, card 2. In fact, we have card 2 all the way up to 14. So you'll notice that when I change this in here, and I update the preview, it's actually going to change the card, right? Change to 13, right? Change this to 14. And if I accidentally change it to a name that doesn't exist, then it actually doesn't show anything. Right? So what we need to do is when the user taps on the deal button, we need to run some code statements that would change what is being passed into this image element and this image element as well. Well, if you think back at the Swift code that you have learned so far, such as variables, constants, functions, there is something that can help us here, right? What I'm referring to are variables. So why don't we go at the top here and declare some variables to represent the cards for the player and the cards for the computer. And that way, when we hit the deal button, we can change the value in those variables. Let me show you what I mean. So put your cursor in front of var and just create a couple of lines right there like that. And we are going to declare a brand new variable to store these two values right here. Instead of, this is called hard coding a string, meaning that when we just put a piece of text here, there's nothing that can refer to that piece of text to change it. So this is what's called a hard-coded value. We are now going to change that so that it can be dynamic. So we declare a new variable using var, right? And I'm going to name this variable player card, and I'm going to assign to it card, let's say 7. And then I'm going to declare another variable. Let's call this one CPU card. And I am going to assign to it card 13, that string right there. And now you can probably see where this is going. In the image element, instead of passing this hard-coded string into here, I can pass in the variable. And because the variable is referencing this string card 7, you can see that that is what this image element displays, right? And I'm going to do the same thing with this CPU card by putting in that variable, referencing that variable, and then passing it to the image element. So now you can see where we're going. When I tap on the deal button and it runs the deal function, inside the deal function, I can change the value that player card is pointing to. I can change CPU card to another string value as well, and that is going to cause the card images to change. Now, I don't want you to do that just yet because there are a couple of details that we need to go through first, but I'm just running through at a high level what our thought process is. Okay, so let's do the same thing for the scores down here, because if you remember when we built this user interface, the scores, we also used some hard-coded values. So down here under player, we hard-coded 0, and under CPU, we hard-coded another 0. Let's go up here and declare two more variables to store those scores. However, this time, I'm going to use an integer because that's going to make it really easy for us to add, right? We can add 1, add 2. We can perform these math operations on an integer. Let's do the same thing to represent the other score right there. And let's go down and change these text elements to refer to these variables that we just created. Okay, so here under player, instead of passing in this hard-coded 0 string, we are going to put player score. Now, you're going to see an error, and I'll tell you why. So let's change this window a little bit. It says no exact matches in call to initializer. So that doesn't really explain very much, to be honest, but I'll explain to you what the issue is. So this text element expects a text piece of data as input, as what to display, you know, for this label. It displays text, but what we are passing into it is an integer, right? It's a number. So it doesn't know how to display that because it's only programmed, it's only built to display pieces of string data. So what we can do is we can actually convert this number, this integer data, into string data. And then, or rather, the string representation of this number, right? So this is how we would do that. Let me get rid of this for now. We are going to create a new piece of string data, type in capital S string, and then open a pair of parentheses. And then in the center, in between it, you are going to put player score. So let's break this down. So first of all, notice that the error goes away. We're good. What we're doing is we're taking this integer and we are turning it into the string representation of that integer. So if it's, you know, the number 10, it's going to be turned into the string 10. And then that is now passed into the text element. So everyone's happy. Let's do the same thing with this one. So we're going to type in string, pair of parentheses. In between that, we're going to put CPU score. And this is called casting. I know it's kind of a weird name, but essentially we are converting the int data to string data. And we're changing the data types. It's called casting. We're casting an int to a string. That's what's happening. All right, so now we are all set up to modify these variables, right? Player card, CPU card, player score, CPU score. We're all set to modify these variables whenever the user taps on the deal button right here inside this deal function. Here's something cool. If you right click on any function, you can jump to the definition. That's basically saying that I want to see what is inside this function. So jump, it's just going to zoom you straight down. It could be in another file even. It'll jump you directly there to see what is this deal function. Right, and all we have to do is modify the code here to change those variables that we just created.
Okay, this is the home stretch. One more lesson to add to app logic and then we're done. Now, if you've been learning a lot from this series, don't forget to hit thumbs up to support this video and don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss that last lesson. I'll see you in that video.